Now, Paulo Freire used to say, you can't use power you don't have. You can't use power you don't have. So, you know, we're very smart people, so we have to sit down and figure out very concretely what powers we bring to the table to recover the authority to do what we know works. Okay, that's the first thing. Now, that's another discussion where we have to think concretely about. Yeah, we have the power to do this. That is, for example, you can make a complaint that BW has been driven off the program with 4Cs, and your complaint with the petition recovers its place in the program. So that's power. Okay. So what power do we have? So we have to make an agenda, like with many items like this, like Rebecca listed. And we have to make a list of what powers don't we have? What can't we do? Like, for example, can we eliminate all the testing machines tomorrow? We can't do that. So the next question is that here's a list of the powers we can count on. Here's all the things we need to do we don't have the power to do. So as Paulo Freire suggested, the next question is, how do you get the power to do what you need to do? That's a very difficult question. How to accumulate enough power to make something happen. So Freire suggested a few ways of working in this regard. He proposed the idea of untested feasibility, by which he meant that whenever there's a power struggle, it's always to the advantage of both sides to fool the other side about who's winning or who's ahead, right? So let's say all the policy authorities on that side, it's to their advantage to convince us that here's how Paulo Freire explains this. Paulo Freire used to go like this and say, okay, you can do what you want over here, but don't come anywhere near this because you're not allowed and this is not possible. And this is a theatrical display. It's like a dramatic utterance or a spectacle to us about, try this and it's over, and so on. So out of fear that going here, it's over, we pull back to here. When actually the line of the possible extends over here, and that the line of the impossible is somewhere in here, but we've been convinced not to test it and try it out. So he said, untested feasibility is that we don't know what's really feasible until we test it with an action that shows us whether or not open space exists for this or that. So another thing we'd have to come up with a whole series of initiatives that were posed against the policy environment to see if in fact the surveillance was very weak over here and very strong over there. And so first thing we do is occupy the space where the surveillance is weak and the vigilance is poor. And that is not always obvious because we're very convinced of a different identity to time and space. So first job we have is to actually occupy all the space that's available. That is, we're already in some space. And it was Paulo Freire's theory that this power battle includes this middle ground where there's really open space for us to occupy. That's indefinite and has to be discovered, as well as a whole lot of space that's blocked and we can't go there. So we have to conceptually approach space and place and time with that understanding. The next thing is that we have allies that, in terms of untested feasibility, we have allies that at the moment we don't approach for assistance. Whatever communities our basic writers come out of, those communities are campaigning for rights and benefits in other regards. Sometimes they have to do with education, but in other regards, especially in immigrant communities, are campaigning now for citizen rights and so on and so on. So the next thing we'd say, who are our friends? Who would like us? And who would we like? We can't be that despised, you know, and so on. In the whole nation, there must be people who think we have something to offer. So the next thing, we have to absolutely find communities of allies who may not be on campus and may not particularly be focused on education.
Testing limits. I also was thinking about what's going on this very day. I haven't heard, but the group that went to the chancellery office and then marched down to Baruch and is out there protesting, some of them in earlier demonstrations have gone to jail, and we all know about this. They're putting this strategy into practice. We'll check our phones as soon as we get out of here and see. I hope that things go well for that effort. I admire them for doing it. I'll just say a couple of other really short things. I think that language discrimination based on language is so powerful and still one of the forms that is practiced all the time. I mean, it's no longer acceptable in public to make racist or sexist or homophobic statements. But people who talk about basic writers and write about basic writers are making these statements all the time. And
we also have developed in the last 40 years a really consequential body of theory, like you mentioned in the very beginning, about literacy and language learning. And some of our really foundational texts are already 30 years old. I mean, like I'm thinking of Shirley Bryce Heath and so on, and some others, which means that these are not novelties. These ideas are not novelties. So what do we know? We learned that that literacy is a social process and most expertly practiced in a social context. The more we decontextualize the act of literacy, the more we hamstring the linguistic competence that all human beings bring to the activity. Okay, so when do we perform at the peak of linguistic competence? We perform at it when we feel most grounded in the rules of discourse and the meaning and the context in which we're doing. So all the folks who come here as basic writers are unfamiliar with the manners of the academy. You know, some are, but phraseology and ways of doing things and what plagiarism means, it seems to be like a very large number of rules that are unfamiliar. So one thing that emerged in the last 30 or 40 years, which had considerable optimism when they first appeared, was Whack in the 1970s and Writing in the Discipline in the 1980s. And each of them was built on a kind of like a linguistic recognition that that language use reaches its greatest competence when there's a material context which makes a lot of sense to the person operating it. So even 100 years ago, Dewey said that teaching language as a thing in itself was just made no sense at all, because that's language. That's not how language is learned or language is practiced. So what do we want to make a claim for then about the curriculum? So we should try to use this knowledge that's already accumulated in the field to become very aggressive in curriculum policy. That is, that literacy has to be practiced and taught and learned, developed in a specific context that brings out the literate genius that all human beings, all normal human beings, bring to their occasion. So if we have a writing class per se that's teaching writing, this has been a debate that's about at least 20 years old now in the field about general writing skills instruction that started with David Russell and others and so on, that we have to find a context in which the use of language was absolutely crucial to figuring out something. So one thing that I think we have to propose in the coming years and debate among ourselves is restructure language study in the university. Restructure it so that it no longer is a autonomous activity. And Brian Street, among other theorists, have argued very deeply that language is just not an autonomous. The Harvey Graf studied the history of this and so on and so on, but that they're all moving in the same direction in what we've called new literacy theory in the last 30 years. So since we know this, we have to have a very concerted offensive around this theory, that is to recover the new literacy theory that began 30 years ago with Shirley and Bryant and so on, and take it seriously that our field should refashion itself around this knowledge, which is so powerful, and so on. And that's another strategy. That is, if we want to invite young instructors of basic writing into a campaign, We should figure out how to wage this campaign and find out a task, many tasks that all of us can do. No one can do it on, it can't be done by one person or two people. So we have many, many things to accomplish, and all the young folks in the field should be given a very, profession-worthy task in this, to do it with, and being introduced, that's professional development. Why are we doing this? We're doing this because this is literacy theory about how folks get really powerful as language users. And it's not the way we're doing it. It's this way instead. So we need you, because I'm going to retire soon, but you are going to be in for the next 40 years. So you want to be miserable? No, you don't want to be miserable. You want to have fun in life. So this is what you have to do. And so what we didn't count on was something that is still not solved, that is a great conundrum. That is that we did solve the pedagogy problem. That is, you get into a classroom with 20 basic writers, and what do you do that makes sense? And many of us in CUNY at that time were at work on this problem. And I was happened to be at Staten Island Community College and so on, but others all around were wrestling with the same problem. And we educated each other year by year on what made sense and what worked, what didn't work. And we didn't have the same perspectives, but we had the same commitments to our students' success. Year by year, what we couldn't cope with was the dramatic change in policy, the policy environment, and that eventually undermined us grotesquely, so that all the progress we did make was, in a sense, ran up against a brick wall around mid and late 70s, and we had to completely reverse or change or grow into a new way of working. For example, at my college, Staten Island Community College, the policy environment was in great disarray around 1970, just before I was hired, and that disarray worked to the advantage of the students and teachers in the classroom. Whenever policymakers lose control of the situation, then they transfer authority and potential to the students and teachers, who are no longer fulfilling mandates, but rather confronting their dilemmas for real in where we are and seeing what makes sense. So year by year, the authorities regained their composure and their momentum, greater attack. For example, 1971, when I joined, there was no entry testing at all. So students showed up, and I always worked registration, that all of us did, because the most important place to be that first week was at the registration table to meet students face to face. They saw they could take basic writing course that we had called English 1, or they could take the regular composition course called English 110. Now, which one they choose was entirely up to them. There was no institutional mandate that said, you are identified as a weak, poor writer, basic writer, or whatever, and you must go there. Don't talk to us, you must go there. So we posed the option to them and said, what course would you like to take? So they said, well, how do I choose? Some of them knew right away what they wanted, some didn't. So the ones who didn't, we would then have on-site counseling right there at that moment about how does a 18-year-old make a choice and so on. And we developed certain ways of working with that moment, what to do. And at the end of it, it was always up to the student where he or she wanted to go. So that was the placement process. It happened, it was homemade, on-site, in process, at registration, informally negotiated between those of us sitting at the table and the students. And wherever they wound up, there was no institutional mandate that identified them with that marked them as a failure or whatever they survived or whatever. So that's the first place to start, that pedagogically we're very rich in what Bourdieu called cultural capital. That is, we really know what to do. And institutionally, we're very weak. And in the policy arena, we are very strong that we can publish and we can teach each other what kind of educational policy at the department level, the college level, university level, and at the state level would help the fates of our basic writing students. We know what to say about the policy, but we're not allowed hearing, so we're not allowed to circulate our policy knowledge. As our policy knowledge is sequestered in journals or it's marginalized. and a singular policy of that we must do it cheaper, we must do it faster, we must do it quicker. They have to hurry up and get in. Do they belong here? Should we move it off campus? All the managerial decisions were very hostile.
Steps back, this is